All right. Well, good evening, everyone. I'm John Giesbrecht. I'm here with John Bolt. We're going to do a little discussion today or teaching on what's going on in the world or what the Bible talks about what's going to happen. You know, this is a topic that a lot of people don't like to teach or a lot of people don't like to even hear about because it's actually a little scary. It's a little scary when you think that your comforts might be taken away from you and all these things that you have, your possessions might not be as good as you think they are or the things that they're going to do for you if this time comes, the end times, right? So that's what we want to talk about a little bit today because there's a lot of people that think that as soon as you talk about the end times that, you know, this... you guys are living in fear, you're radical, you should stop doing this kind of stuff and just go back to normal, start doing all the normal things that the normal people do, right? But if you think about it a little bit, if it is true, and again, we're going to speculate a lot. We're not going to say a lot of these things that we're going to talk about is, end time events. Again, like I say, we're going to speculate a lot on these things, but a lot of these things are biblical. A lot of these things are going to come to pass, and especially when things happen in Israel. We know as soon as, you know, Israel and we hear about news in Israel and you hear about that, then you know it's coming to the end times, right? Because I think a lot of times people don't understand this is that God is still going to do something with the Jewish people. You know, there's a big difference between when you think, take a Gentile or a Jew, which most of us are Gentiles, but God is still not done with the Jewish people. If you read in Romans chapter 11, you'll find that there's still going to be things that God's going to do with his people, his chosen people, the elect, the Jewish nation. So let's take our Bibles and turn to the book of Revelations. In the book of Revelations, we're going to start off here in Revelations in chapter 13, starting in verse 14. It says this, and deceiveth them that dwell on the earth by the means of those miracles, which he had power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth, that they should make an image to the beast, which had the wound by a sword and did live. And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, and that the image of the beast should both speak, and cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. And he causeth all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their forehead, and that no man might buy or sell, save he that hath the mark, or the name of the beast, or the number of his name. Here is wisdom. Let him that hath understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 666. You know, when we hear this 666, a lot of people, they get frightened. Or, you know, I know a lot of people when they even have a license plate or something and have 666, they don't want to drive the car. But we have to understand something here is that there is going to come a day when these numbers or this mark is going to be broadcast, is going to be manifest, or is going to come to reality. The Bible says it. Like I said in my starting statement is that very often people don't like hearing about this because of their comfort. If you think a little bit about the days of Noah, when Noah started building that ark, people were mocking him because it took him over 100 years to build this ark. So people started mocking him because, man, he's been doing it for over 100 years and it's still not happening. So the same thing is what is happening today. You know, a lot of things have gone on in this world that people can say, oh, people thought it back then too. But one thing we do know that we are closer to the end than we ever have been before. We're living in something that I think a year and a half ago, we would have said that is never going to happen. You know, if you think about it, a year and a half ago, before this COVID pandemic or whatever they call it started, none of us would say that, look, in a year and a half, or not even in a year and a half, in a half a year, whenever it started, that you're all going to walk around with wearing masks if you go into a store. Or, you know, worst of all, as you probably all heard of this pastor that got arrested in Edmonton, Alberta. Back in the day or a year and a half ago, none of us would have expected that. If somebody would have said, you know what, a year and a half, you know, there's going to be pastors arrested, but not just that, if they're going to open up, we're going to put a fence around it. Most people would have said, you are crazy for thinking that. The world is not ready for that. But guess what, a year and a half after, or over a year after, it happens. So what can happen in the next year? You know, you start thinking of this vaccination that they just came out with, that they want people to start maybe having a vaccination passport, a green pass or whatever they call it. We know that it's already happening in Israel. And like I said, as soon as I hear the word Israel, my ears start really opening because we know that world events, the end time events, are going to be centered around Israel. So when we heard that this COVID vaccination was going to come around and that they were going to build up a passport, that you would have to have a passport to go into certain places, or even some people think that, you know, you could lose your job. And if we think of this number, I'm not saying this is the 666. I'm saying there is a 666 coming. But what I'm saying is that this seems to be leading up to that. Because if you think of where we're at already with this vaccination passport and how the whole COVID thing and the whole scenario started coming along, and it's up to this point where people are living in fear, or the media is trying to drill fear into people, where, you know, everybody is doing things that they've never done. Stop gathering together as believers and wearing masks, and, you know, no more gatherings or whatever the government and the health officials want you to stop. We never expected this, but it's happening. So we do know that there's an agenda behind this. You know, even if you think about the vaccinations and how long, you know, it usually takes to make a vaccination. Now in this COVID thing, now they all of a sudden, it takes them not even half the time to make this vaccination. I don't think it's coincidence. I don't think that this is all in their convenience, but I think that they were planning this. There's an agenda here. Just like anything that has come up to this point, as I said, with the church buildings, doors being closed, people stop gatherings, and people want people to isolate, and they start with isolation facilities and all these things. And it seems really strange. And I think all of us can start saying there's something very suspicious going on. So that's why we wanted to do this topic here, is because I think all of us have had the thought, or are thinking, is this have something to do with end time events? As I read in Revelations, there is a time that there is going to be a mark of the beast. And if any man does not have that mark, he will be killed. And if any man takes that mark, he's going to burn in hell. So, but what happens before this event? So I'm going to ask John, maybe you can explain a little bit something that happens before the mark of the beast.
All right, yeah. This is an exciting topic always for me. Revelations. You know, people think of Revelation, they think it's just end times, but all through the Bible, you'll see end times. We took a bunch of verses here, and even Corinthians and stuff explaining rapture. Many people get very confused. There's two different comings. I know there's many disputes on this, and you probably listening say you don't believe in this, but I'll say it this way: every Christian believes in a rapture. We just debate a little bit about the timing. Now I'll say this: we don't know the timing. Nobody does know the timing. You will not know the day or the hour. He says it's not given to you. It's going to happen as a thief in the night. Let's read some stuff here in 1 Corinthians 15:50. Now this happens before the mark of the beast, before we go through the great tribulation, as many know as a 7-year tribulation. This needs to happen before we have enough scripture to prove it. But he says, "Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither doth corruption inherit incorruption." This is 1 Corinthians 15, verse 50. Take your Bibles and read with. Don't just believe whatever you hear or see. But he says, look, flesh and blood will not be able to enter. And he explains something, how your body is going to need to drop. It's going to need a different body. If you're getting to heaven, it can't be this corrupted flesh that you see, you feel. It's going to need to drop it one way or another. He says, verse 51, "Behold, I show you a mystery." It's something that's not understood. This is something that hasn't been understood up to this point. He said, look, I'm going to show you now a mystery. "We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed." He's saying not everybody's. Now, sleep is a word that we use for death. When a Christian dies, because you have eternal life, but when you drop your body, you go into the grave, he says he calls that as a Christian sleeping. He's not really sleeping. That's the word the Bible uses for a dead Christian, a Christian who's died, who's waiting for a resurrection. And he says, look, I'll show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep. Not all Christians are going to die when this time comes. There'll be Christians alive and remain. They'll be walking this earth when the rapture happens. He says, but you will be changed then. The body still has to change. And he says, verse 52, "In a moment, in a twinkling of an eye." He says, this will happen in a moment. This will happen quick. This will not happen like you read about in Matthew 24, where he says every eye shall see and Jesus will come down and knee will fall. Think about it. That's not a moment. As fast as this is going to happen, you wouldn't be able to drop to your knees that quick. He says this is in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye. This is not even quite a blink. It's quicker than a blink of an eye. He says, "At the last trump, For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. He's saying we as in who's ever alive at that time. He said when this trumpet, it will happen so quick. The dead will rise, the Christians will be changed. And he says in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, this is going to happen. Now, one thing you see is a trumpet shall sound. Is God just going to blow a trumpet? We know Jesus says, my sheep hear my voice. When God comes calling, he says his children will hear it. Whatever it is, whether it be. Now, we took some verses that we found. Look in Revelations 4:1. He says, after this, I looked. He says, and behold, a door was open in heaven. Now, this we believe chapter 4 is the last time the church was mentioned in Revelations. So we believe this is where the rapture happens. The door opens in heaven. And the first voice which I heard was, as it were, of a trumpet talking with me. So again, now he uses saying, John gets up in spirit form, gets caught up, and sees what's going to happen ahead of time. God shows him, takes him to heaven and shows him what's going to happen ahead of time. And he says, and John's like, it was as if a trumpet was talking to me. So we see similarity that maybe this trumpet, even in the rapture, it will be Jesus calling, but it'll be loud like a trumpet that Christians will hear. But here he says, a trumpet talking with me, which said, come up hither, and I will show thee things which must be hereafter. And he's going to talk about what happens after he takes him up. So that's where you can see, if this is the rapture, which we believe it is, rapture taking place here, then you'll get caught up, and the hereafter is the tribulation where it starts. That's where, with this fear you got going on, people living in fear and all this Mark of the Beast stuff, it is coming, and I say, you know, do your research and look into it, and you see it. Don't get deceived with what's going on. There's so much confusion, and you see deception on both sides of the story. There's people that would say if you take this vaccination that you're probably taking 666. We do believe that it will lead up to it. We don't know for sure. I'm not saying that is for sure. But everything you're seeing, the stuff they're saying, if you follow enough, they're saying eventually they're taking away more and more rights. Can't go to hockey games or can't go to these theaters or these events. They'll cut it off from people who are not willing to get vaccinated, right? So they're going to start to use, no, we're not going to force everyone, but you can see slowly. Go watch the videos in Israel. Go look at what they already have. They're already doing this. Next is going to be what? In Britain, UK, these kind of areas. And then it's going to be in Canada and wherever else you are listening to this, it'll follow. And you'll see it's coming quicker than we think. There's so many people that are looking for, oh, this is going to go back to normal. You're kind of deceiving yourself, and I see why. For a while there, it's almost like I was telling people, too, let's just shut this out, ignore it, stop listening to media, because they're just putting fear in you, and that's true. It's true, they're putting fear in you. They're trying to, you know, put fear into people. But on the flip side, what you're doing is you're falling asleep as a Christian, too. What you're doing is you're falling asleep to the idea that this world does got to end, and it ends in a negative way. You can see as it gets to the end, the church is useless. It falls asleep. It ain't doing much for anything. You see a few. You see that with everything going on, there's a few pastors here and there standing up, but it's very few. It's very few, and you can see it's offending the world. It's always been offensive, and now they're doing something about it. You know, you mentioned the church in Calgary. You see it. Why really put a gate around it? Why shut it down the way they have? When they had no COVID cases, right? If I'm right, he says that they have no COVID cases. And I believe it's true. I believe it's true what he's saying. There was no COVID cases the whole time they were open. So they didn't shut it down because some COVID spike in there or this or that, or that's where COVID comes from. But it gets under the name of that, under the name of this sickness and stuff. And the only way to reopen is to be under their demand, under their control. I say this, we're not fighting flesh and blood. So anybody listening to this, if you're a liberal and you fall for all this media stuff, don't get offended. I don't even think you're necessarily a bad person or a worse person than any of us here. It's just that I believe there's a devil behind this. It's not this is not just humans doing this kind of stuff. It's the devil who's deceived humans, who is now deceiving further. And it's just corruption upon corruption. And it is going to end in corruption. You see the church falling away. And the church getting cold, and God's going to, he's going to come, and you got to see what the rapture is. It's not a second chance to get saved. The rapture is when you get taken up before the tribulation, is actually God cutting off the church, saying, I'm sick of the church being useless. It's sleeping anyway. I'm taking it out of here, and I'm going to send judgment on this earth. So people are going back to say, we're gonna go back to peace. This thing's gonna go all right. We're gonna make it all good. And we know what the Bible has to say that when they say peace and safety, he says then sudden destruction. Look what he says in 1 Thessalonians 4:13. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. Don't be crying always about the dead Christians, because they're not dead and gone forever. It's just they just dropped their body and they're asleep for now. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. He says, for this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. In other words, it says the ones dead in Christ, they'll go first. And we're not going to hold them back or hold them up or in any way. He says, so don't be crying over those dead loved ones that you have that were Christians. He says, they're going to get raised up actually first, and we're not going to prevent them. He says, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise. So Christ is coming. Now people get confused because they hear Jesus coming. They tie it all together with Matthew 24, like I said, and where every eye shall see in the valley of Megiddo and the earthquake happens. He puts his foot on the mountain. We have an appointment. Christ, we're coming together. We are a meeting place. We are meeting Christ. He says we will meet him in the clouds. There's clearly passages in Thessalonians and that says we'll meet him in the clouds, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. See, once we meet up with the Lord, we're always going to be with the Lord. When Christ actually comes back, like Matthew 24, we're actually going to be with him. It says he's going to have all the holy angels with and all the saints with. If you're a saint, you're saved, and you're a saint, you will actually be coming with down when that event happens if you're saved. If not, you'll be the one on the ground and bowing your knee at that time. He says, then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up. That's where we get the word rapture. Nowhere in the King James Bible do we have the word rapture, but we get that Latin word from the word caught up. So we're going to be caught up together. God's going to bring us together, Christians, with God, with him. He says, with them in the clouds. We're being raptured up, caught up with them, with the dead ones that you love and all the Christians, with them. We'll be caught up together to meet. It's as if I said, let's go to Timmy's. Don't come to my house. Let's just go to Timmy's. I'll meet you there. It's different than Jesus coming to your house. He's meeting you somewhere. He says, we will meet the Lord where? In the air. We have a meeting place. He told you the destination. We're meeting him in the air. He's not coming to put his foot on the mountain and coming to visit you just yet. He says, we will meet him in the air. You can clearly see how there's two different comings. Now, once you study in that a little deeper, you'll see, and we'll try to talk about a little bit more here, you will see that that is before the mark of the beast. This kind of stuff happened before. Is there anything you wanted to add to that?
I was just going to add, because, you know, there's probably someone listening right now that probably has never heard of this. Because that's I know, even the way we grew up, from the religion that we grew up, they would never teach us. This would be something completely new to them. So maybe you're listening and you probably have never heard of a rapture or of this getting caught up, or, you know, all of a sudden in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, these people just leave, right? But that, it's biblical. If you study your scripture, you'll find that there is a place, just like John was reading here in scripture, that there's a time, like one time, that it's going to be as a twinkling of an eye and there will be a rapture. You'll be changed in the air, and that's where you're going to meet Jesus Christ. So it's just interesting to think that, you know, somebody watching this maybe after we get raptured, you know, it's a little bit creepy to think that what if that would happen. So, you know, somebody could watch this and think, whoa, what happened? What happened to a lot of these people? Because after this, I know the scripture talks about God's going to send a great delusion, that he's going to send a delusion because people have always wanted to believe in lies. Now God's going to send a delusion. So a lot of these people are going to get confused. They're going to don't know what happened, what's going on. They'll be making up stuff because God's going to send them that, because people have always tried to believe a lie. But before this event happens, I would tell you this, that start seeking for truth. So that's what I was going to add to that. But, yeah, you can keep going on.
Absolutely.
That.
Yeah, no, you need to seek for truth, because you only have this life at this time. Later there will be. You think, I think of the world as, could it be possibly more deceived? but it can. You know, scripture-wise, it'll say it's only going to get worse and worse. And so there is no, you know, you hear it over the news all the time, stuff, oh, get used to it. Maybe this mask thing, it's the new normal. And I know there's a lot of people saying, nope, we're not going to do that, and we're not going to do that. And that's fine. I feel the same way. And because, but here's the thing, I'm not so upset with, let's say, even just the mask and all that right now. But we just see where that's going. Masks turn to vaccinations, and vaccination eventually probably have the micro technology. That's what we kind of figure. We don't know. We don't know how they're going to do it, how the Antichrist is going to do it. It's not people. Antichrist, how he's going to do it? Through people. He's going to get it, but it'll be in your right hand or your forehead and probably some barcode, and you can't do nothing. You can't buy or sell or anything. And those that take it, you've now signed yourself over, say, I belong to the world. I belong to the world. You, and anybody that knows a little bit of scripture, you know that you belong to the world, you belong to the devil, and you go where the devil goes, to hell, for all eternity. Look at what it says in Matthew 24:40. Now, if you read Matthew, most of Matthew is explaining the second coming, when Jesus actually comes, and the Jews ask, what are the signs of the signs of thy coming and of the end of the world? That's what they ask. So Jesus, he's talking about a bunch of earthquakes and things that you'll see happening. He said those are not signs. See, many people have taken those as signs, but we've always had those. He says, no, these things will happen. And then he says, then you will see, he says, and then he talks about a guy coming, standing up in the temple, the Antichrist, standing up in the temple, desecrating the temple. He says, when you see that, he says, now the end is very, very near. So they were asking about the end of the world. This is after the rapture. But then he gets to Matthew 24:40, and he hits a little bit of the rapture. This is clearly different. You would see also, how does this fit in there? And people that are post-trib kind of belief will say, no, this is just simply teaching how God's just going to, he's going to have some people saved, some people lost. Well, he could have said it in many different ways. If you read it carefully, you'll see that it's deeper than just that. He says, then shall two be in the field. The one shall be taken and the other left. Verse 41, that's Matthew 24:41. Two women shall be grinding at the mill. The one shall be taken and the other left. Look, he's saying quickly, you're at your job. You're with a coworker. You're a believer, and he's not, or the other way around. He's a believer, and you are not. When this happens, this twinkling of an eye, this something quick, just like that, like a thief comes and takes something at nighttime, and you only find out hours later that what had happened. That's how the rapture happens. The second coming doesn't happen that way. He says, look at Matthew 24:42. Watch, therefore, because of this, he says, you need to watch, therefore, for ye know not what hour your Lord doth come. The rapture, we cannot know the hour. We can't know, I don't even think we can as close as a season, but you can start seeing when the season's getting ready. You can see when, okay, summer's coming. We don't know if it's coming this summer. We don't know if the rapture is this summer. We're going into spring here, soon summer. We don't know. I cannot preach and say that. I'd be a false teacher, false preacher. I cannot say that. Do I feel like it? Yes, a lot of Christians. I feel like it could be very soon. I feel like it could be this year. It might not be, and I won't get my hopes just up just yet. I'm excited for when it comes. But he says, watch therefore. Don't fall asleep. Jesus asked the disciples, he said he was going to go pray. Well, he was about to get delivered up, Judas to betray him. He said, can you not stay up and watch? The Christians, Jesus' followers, disciples, and so the church today, they always have an issue with falling asleep. And so it is in these days. You see the church falling asleep. They don't give an ear to sound doctrine anymore. Many of you have probably shut this video off already, saying, you know what, this is just maybe not that interesting. I'm a post-trib believer. I'm not a, you know, these guys are King James people. I'm not a King James. And they tune you out because they set their mind to something. That's a person who's very easily to get deceived because he's not open-minded to see what the scripture has to say. Now, I get it if you tune me out, but you need to see what the scripture says. Read it for yourself. See what the scripture has to say. He says, you need to watch. You need to be watching. And he says, but you will not know when it's come. It'll be like a thief in the night. He says, it'll be like you went to bed. Morning, you wake up, you're missing half your stuff. He says, you didn't know what happened. You didn't see it coming. If you would have known, you would have set up security cameras. You would have been guarding with your shotgun all night there, but you didn't know. He says, just like that, he says, you need to be watching. We need to be awake. We need to be sober. And we need to be preaching the gospel, reaching people. And that's why we feel it necessary to even talk about the rapture, to get you guys excited, because there's lots of fear, dismotivation, and churches we can't meet in our building and this and that. And yes, it's very irritating because we see where this is getting and going, and people are forsaking the assembling ourselves. It's not good for Christians. But I want to also say this. Don't rely just on a building. The church was never a building, and now you can really feel it. When you're missing your building, you can't really get together in your building, you feel like you're spiritually drained. Well, it shouldn't be like that. You can get the scriptures and all the more pray, read, and get together with Christians as you can. As you can, the little bit you can still, right? Still go and you find encouragement. You go to the Lord. You go straight to the Lord. But I know many are so used to going to pastors and teachers and getting their encouragement and their weekly spanking and Sunday morning. But there's more to the Christian life than that. We need to be watching, praying. And yes, I do believe that we shouldn't be forsaking the assembling of ourselves. But the building, it was never about the building. Jesus said, there's a day coming, you'll not worship me in a temple or on the mountain. He says, in truth and in spirit. We still got that. Nobody can take that from us. Nobody can take truth and spirit from us. So we're trying to bring truth to you here and spread a little bit. And I hope the rapture gets you excited like it does us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, yeah, just like you were saying, like, very often people get discouraged or, you know, they're discouraged because they can't get their system back or they can't get the way they live their life,
that's
their
right.
luxuries back and stuff. And I think that's very often, like I think it was mentioned in the earlier statements that, you know, people don't want to believe this. They don't want this to be the end. They don't want this to come to the end. They don't want this to be the new normal, what we would call it. Or they don't want, you know, there's going to be an Antichrist standing up. That's why, you know, you'll hear people making statements like, no, people have always said this. People have always said this. Or you'll hear people make statements like, oh, no, the world is not ready for that. People are not ready for that. You know, just like I said, that we never thought a year and a half ago that we would be ready for this. We never thought that this is how easily things can turn, where people are walking around with masks, that people are, you know, vaccinations, that you might not be able to travel, that, you know, a lot of businesses might not hire you, a lot of businesses you won't even be able to buy or sell or whatever you do is because of vaccination. It sure does sound like the mark of the beast, but just like you mentioned, we don't believe this is the mark of the beast, because I believe that when you take the mark of the beast or when that comes, that you're going to have to pledge your allegiance to the devil. Like, this is going to be very often, very easy that you're going to deny Jesus Christ and you're not saved, because we don't believe in a loss of salvation. We believe that a person, when he is saved, he's always saved. Like, he's going to go to heaven. He's going to have eternal life. So in the 7-year tribulation, there's going to be people that when they get the mark, that they're not going there. They're going straight to hell. So I think it's just a thing that we all need to realize, that let's not think of this as, hey, it's going to go back to normal. It's going to go back to normal. Because I often think of what the spiritual battle actually looks like behind us. We don't see it. You know, we see the physical thing going on. But you actually start wondering, is the Antichrist already somewhere? Is he already roaming somewhere that we just haven't seen him? Who is he? We don't know that. And we're not saying if this is, you know, he's already living or where he is. We're not saying that. Again, a lot of this stuff is us speculating on, hey, this looks like it's what Scripture says, because we do believe in every single word of the Bible. We do know there's a time coming that there's going to be an Antichrist, that there's going to be a 666, but we also believe that there's a time coming for a rapture, that these Christians are going to get raptured up, and we won't be going through the 7-year tribulation. See, a lot of people think when people that believe in a pre-tribulation rapture, they think, oh, you just don't want to go through all the 7 years and get persecuted. And of course, we don't want to. But the Bible says that. You know, the Bible talks about the rapture. The Bible talks about a pre-tribulation rapture. That's why we believe it, because the 7 years is for the Jewish people. And you'll read that again. I didn't write those verses down here, but in Romans in chapter 11, you'll find that when it talks about those branches being broken off, and then that when they're broken off and the Gentiles are taken out, that's when God's going to start grafting back in the Jewish branches. We know about the 144,000. This is a house of Israel shall be saved. These are all Israelites. These are Jewish people. So there's a lot of scripture references to the pre-tribulation rapture. And I think eventually we'll go in more into that and to deeper teachings on that. But that's just a big thing that I don't want people to think, oh, you guys just don't want to, you're just scared to go through this stuff. Of course I am. I wouldn't want to go through it, but it's actually biblical. If we keep our eyes open and we seek what the Bible says, that's what we find in there.
Yeah, absolutely. Because the biggest thing is you don't want to live in fear. Nowhere do you find that Christians should live in fear, spend their time in fear. It is a fearful time. I know of Christians that they're terrified of what's coming. And if I really think about what's coming and watching the news and stuff, there is a sense of, oh man, if that comes, if this comes, and almost as if sometimes you can forget about what the scripture actually says about the end coming. All the more when we see these things, it could possibly, we should look at, say, possibly the rapture is right around the corner. We don't know, but possibly. Because he says this in 1 Thessalonians 5:1, but of the times and the seasons, brethren, ye have no need that I write unto you. He says, there's no need for me to write unto you and tell you the times and seasons. He says, for you yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. The day of the Lord, here he's saying as the rapture, because he's saying, you won't see it coming. You know that he's coming like a thief. It's sudden. It's quick. You ain't going to see it coming anyway. So there's no need me telling you or saying, look for a sign. It's so quick, you wouldn't have time to look for a sign. But we find that when Jesus actually comes back, the second coming comes in Israel and puts his feet on the mountain, there's a lot leading up to it. He says you'll see the Antichrist standing up in the temple, then you flee into the mountains, and then there'll be months there. You see this time, you could literally count the days to where the end of the world is. At that time, from where you see Antichrist standing up, they could do a count and find out exactly what day. So that's how you know there's a big time difference. He says you won't even know the season here, never in the hour. He says it's going to be so quick, so sudden. That's why there's not much on the rapture when it's going to happen. We just know it's before. That's all we know. That's why we like, we can get close. But that's about it. He says, for when they shall say, this is 1 Thessalonians 5:3. For when they shall say, the not do or not have, he says say. And they've been saying this. Peace and safety. Then sudden destruction cometh upon them as a as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. It's like a woman when their water breaks. Oh, the baby's coming. You got a very little bit of time now, he says. Just like that, he says, when they say peace and safety, then we're getting close. We're getting really close. Sudden destruction's coming. Just like a woman that's about to have a baby. She knows she's about to have a baby. There's no question she's about to have. He says, but ye, brethren, are not in darkness, that day should overtake you as a thief. Listen, he says. So are you this? You know, this is where we want to bring in the gospel. Are you a child of the light? Are you a child that's walking in light, understands light, follows the light? Because that's where you need to make sure you're at. You better be in the light in this. You know, it seems like there's so many professing Christians and you're not sure if they're even saved because they're so in darkness with everything. So in darkness, whether they're saved or not, I don't know. Doesn't that sound dark to you to not even know where you're going? People think, how could you know? Well, you only know once you know. So get saved and find out. Get born again, you'll know. You'll know because God's spirit is in you. You know when you're God's child. When you've trusted Christ, it's based on the scripture. You believe the scriptures. Once you believe what the Bible has to say about Jesus doing the work, you become a child of God. When you trust in Jesus and what he did alone, then you are a child of light because Jesus says, I am the light. We know that Jesus is the light. So to be a children of light, that's children of Jesus. And he says, and they're children of day. He says, but the thief's coming at night. Remember that? Thief's coming at night. He says, you won't see it coming and stuff. But he says, it won't really overtake you. It doesn't really matter when it happens. You don't need to worry because you're of the day. It doesn't really matter. We are not of the night nor of darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as do others, but let us watch and be sober. He says, you need to start watching. This is what we need to do as a Christian. Watch. Don't tune your ears out and say, I'm not listening to this stuff. I don't want to see the end times coming. I like my job, and I think it's going to go all back to normal. You need to be watching a little bit. I know we've been saying a lot like, okay, shut the media out and this kind of stuff. And to a certain point, yes, especially when it comes to all the scare about you getting sick. Don't worry about you getting sick. Worry about how sick you already are with sin and that corruption. Where did the fear of God come in people ever? They have such fear over a cough and a cold that'll sentence them to maybe a death, to a cough that could die. Okay, let's say there's such a thing as COVID, you could die, you could. Why are you so terrified of that when really you were dying all along? You were dying all along. You only have a short life. It's a vapor. Why are you not seeking Christ when you're still alive and healthy and without cancer or without COVID? That's what we're trying to wake people up. To be seeking to get saved now, to get sober now, and become a child of the light.
Yeah, because the one thing where we started off in the beginning is in 1 Corinthians in chapter 15, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 53, the Bible says, For this corruptible must put on incorruptible, and this mortal must put on immortality. Like, this is the people that are getting raptured. These are the people that are from corruptible are putting on incorruptible, from mortal putting on immortality, from immortality. And so when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall he be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. And then verse 55 says, O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. You know, I heard a story about a little boy that was running away from a bee. The bee was flying after him and trying to sting him and land on him. And the mother comes there and kind of chases the bee away, and the mother gets stung. And the boy comes up to the mother and says, is the bee going to get me? And the mother says to the son, no, the bee only has one sting. And you know, that's just like the gospel. Jesus God took that sting. That's why he says, O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? There is no victory for the grave. There is no victory for death, because Jesus Christ overcame that. And he overcame that for me and for you. So we will not taste death. We will not experience the death that the unbeliever experiences. We just experience this physical death, but we have eternal life. We've passed from death unto life. We have eternal life. That's when he says in John, he talks about, you shall know that you have eternal life. And he says that you have eternal life means that you have it. As soon as you put your trust in Jesus Christ, as soon as you are persuaded that Jesus Christ is enough for your salvation, as soon as you are persuaded and saying to, oh, death, where is thy sting? Jesus Christ took the sting. As soon as you can say that and you're persuaded, that means you are now a believer. That means that you are saved. You know, very often, I think the gospel can get confused to people because, like, they think they have to go through a four-step program. They have to do a sinner's prayer. They have to do all this stuff, but it's so simple. It's just when you are persuaded by the gospel of Jesus Christ, when you believe that this is all it is, this is all I need. I don't need to have all these works. You know, after we get saved, we have these works and we don't fall asleep, but as to get salvation, it's not about what you do. It's Jesus Christ. He took that sting. That bee was chasing us, but he took it. So we can say now too, O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain and in the Lord. What a beautiful passage, knowing that Jesus Christ took that for us. So that's why, I don't know if you got anything more to add as far as to a non-believer, if he's listening here.
Well, to non-believer, it's just that. You kind of said it. You need to see it, that the final payment. See, because even one of the things, and we'll go into greater detail maybe in the future on these videos, but is rightly dividing God's word. Why people get confused in rapture. Why people get confused in many doctrines, but the most important one is salvation. Is because the Bible does speak of it. People say, what about James? What about it? It's a word of God. I believe every word of it. You know, and I was studying James today, in the book of James, but some people may sound like, but doesn't that book pretty much contradict? And they don't say that, but they're saying, when I give them the plain old gospel and say it's belief only, somebody will throw at you, a religious person will throw at you, what about the book of James? Now, I know where they're going with that. They're saying it can't be belief only because they have another passage that I would say you're taking out of context. You're ripping it out of where it belongs. Timothy says you need to rightly divide God's word. When I was talking about Matthew, most of Matthew is about Jesus' second coming. It's actually after the tribulation. You got all this the moon will be darkened, turned to blood, all these signs of Jesus coming back. But he says, but the rapture, no sign. No sign of the rapture, no sign of the rapture. We know it's before that, no sign. So we're not even giving you a sign. We're not giving you nothing to look for. We just know that if you see what's going on in Israel, you can see they're getting closer for the mark of the beast. They're getting closer for the great tribulation. We just know the rapture is something before that. We don't know what season. We know what day. We don't know what hour. But you see how we get all that is by rightly dividing God's word. The gospel is the same. So if you're confused, there is, you know, greater proofs that we can give to you. And we want to do that over time. Ask the questions. We gave the phone number. I think we'll put it in the description below. Again, a phone number that we dedicated to this group. For people that say, yeah, but what about this? You know, and we'll be gracious with you. We don't look to nitpick the stuff. We won't name you, but just an anonymous ask a question and we'll try to have it answered. Because I know there's confusion. I'm sure there's people watching this say they have some kind of religion or their pastor maybe disagrees. And whatever. I'm not here to argue. I just need to stand up for God's word. But when you rightly divide it, when you see what belongs where, what belongs at the rapture, what belongs at the second coming, what belongs to salvation, what is salvation, what about repent, where does repentance come in? Well, what does repent even mean? Most people would say it means to be fall on your knees and be super sorry for your sin and just cry and bawl your eyes out and then believe the gospel. So they believe that you need to do that plus because someone says repent and believe and be you baptized. Some say maybe you even got to get baptized. So is it three things to get saved? Is it two things? Is it one thing? But then later you got to maintain good works. Otherwise you'll lose your salvation. Well, why do they get that? Well, in Revelations, if you take the mark of the beast, that wouldn't be a good work. You'd lose your salvation. Very clear. Very clear. There's many things that if you don't rightly divide God's word, you will come up with all kinds of doctrine. People say, well, you can make the Bible say whatever you want it to. Yeah, if you read it once a month and take it out of context, like you read a verse a day, or maybe you get a verse a day in your Bible app. You ain't reading enough and you ain't taking it in context. If you take it in the context, you will actually come up with a much better doctrine, and you need to rightly divide. Who's it saying it to? Who was Jesus talking to, or Paul? Who was it written to? Was it written to a Jew? Romans is like that. Often you were mentioning Romans. Many confusions in Romans about Calvinism and many other doctrines because of not dividing God's word. What belongs where? Dividing is when you, like God divided the waters from the land and that, those kind of things. We know what it means. And you follow a word through in the scripture and you'll see salvation is this. I'll sum it up to you now and we'll another time prove it. But it is believing in the Lord Jesus Christ and what he's done, his finished work. Believing. It's a non-work. When we think of work, you're thinking law. And if anything, in Romans, we'll clearly disprove that. And so with Galatians, if it would be, it's the most offensive thing you could do to God is try to work for your salvation after he's given it to you. It's super offensive to think that you're good works, which he says is like a filthy rag. It's still a dirty rag. He says you need to have spotless clothes. And he clearly said your good works. This is not your bad works. This is your good works is as a dirty rag. He says no dirty rags coming up to heaven. So even good works, it cannot outweigh your bad. It does not undo your bad. If you go commit murder, all the good works on the face of the earth would still not keep you out of prison once you get caught. Mm-hmm. So even our justice system would condemn that sin, and somebody has to take that sting. Yep. You and John explained it. Jesus took that sting for us. He took that sting. If you cannot believe that that sting was taken already, no, I just don't believe that. Well, then you are an unbeliever. And then go read about what John 3 says about that. If you believe not, you are condemned already. You are condemned. So you say, I don't know where I'm going. Well, do you not believe that your sins are gone based on the Lord Jesus Christ and what he's done? Well, then you should know. You are condemned. And I don't mean this to be rude or offensive, but you stop guessing where you're going. You know where you're going. You will die and you will go to hell. But if you're still alive, you still have an opportunity to change your mind about that. Read the scriptures. Well, I just can't believe it. Read more. Ask more questions. Are you seeking? The Bible says seek and you will find. If people would get out their Bible and seek instead of arguing and debating it all day, rather ask questions. See, if I'm wrong, shut me out. Go listen to something else. But your salvation is at stake. And I believe we're living close to the end. We feel a need to talk about the rapture, get excited about the rapture. Don't completely ignore what's going on in the world, because that tells us that we're getting closer. Our redemption draws nigh. It's closer. It's closer. We know one thing. It's closer than it was 100 years ago. We're definitely closer. So don't let dumb sayings like, oh, they've been saying this for 100 years. Because for over 100 years, they mocked Noah. Mm-hmm. So that all tells me all the more, if it's as it was in the days of Noah, then all the more you should perk up your ears, because now the 100 days are almost up. So that means we're probably even closer, and the mocking's only getting harder and stronger and more unbelievers, when really we should be watching, we should be looking. What's going on? Israel's our clock, because God always talks about Israel, and Israel's going to be the one going through the tribulation. Israel was the one, he said, the disciples were Jewish. They were in Israel asking Jesus these questions. What's the sign of the end time? He gave it straight to Jews at that time. That's what I'm saying. Who was Jesus talking to? He was saying to the Jewish people, and he was telling them, those who are in Judea, flee. Do you live in Judea? I got a hard time believing that anybody in Judea is listening to this video right now. Maybe one day I'll reach there. But if you are, and you're going to live in the tribulation, and we're already raptured out of here, and you're still listening to this video, then you can read Matthew 24 and tells you what to do. Flee, because the devil is in your town. And that's coming. It's coming, guys. It's a Bible prophecy. It's coming. Mock and laugh all you want, but one day you will bow, and you think this is fear. The real fear is yet to come. Mm-hmm. And it ain't done by men. I believe even this, we see it. The stuff, the corruption that's going on, has been going on in even in the U.S. and what we see in Canada here, it's so corrupt. It feels like there's no one doing it. And people say, yeah, well, we should stand up and fight. Well, you're going to have to fight a whole lot harder because you're fighting the devil. So I think you need to get on your knees a whole lot more then, and not so much yelling, because the devil doesn't care for that.
Yeah. So, yeah, just in closing, one thing I was going to add too is a lot of people, like you were mentioning, people like, oh, you just have to believe. And they think, well, I believe, all these people believe. But they really don't, because they're still working for their salvation, right?
Yeah.
If you say, well, I believe, and you're still working for your salvation, then you don't believe. You actually don't believe
that
Jesus
Christ. Your works prove that you don't.
Your works prove it, that you don't believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and his finished work. So I first of all want to thank you guys all for tuning in. And if you have any questions, like John was mentioning, we'll put a number on the description. You can text that or WhatsApp that and share the video. Thank you.